I was sort of in New York at exactly the right time and exactly the right place.
Wherever you are is the center. But I can be in more than one place at the same time. Things seemed to be really happening fast.
He was born face up instead of face down, which the doctor called sunny side up. I guess I should have known right then something was going to be up, huh?
I grew up in a really small town in Pennsylvania called Kutztown, which is northeast of Philadelphia. I grew up learning to draw from my father from about the time when I was about 4 years old. And my father used to entertain me by making small drawings for me. And I think the biggest impression that it had was that instead of teaching me to copy other cartoon characters or comics, he wanted me to invent my own characters.
We had a game where we'd see how good we could do drawing with your eyes closed, which is a good practice for getting the rhythm of your hand and knowing where your hand is and what it's doing without watching, without seeing it.
I mean, I was really obsessed with Walt Disney a lot. I loved Walt Disney. So I watched cartoons all the
time. In senior high school, he had an art teacher who was really good, and he devoted more time to art. He got an honorable mention. And he got $100. And he was so proud of this. It was his first money that he got from anything, for any of his drawings. And he said, okay, I won that $100. He said, I'm gonna use that $100. And he paid his first down payment to go to school in Pittsburgh. It was a big decision. Our son was going off to the big city. I mean, Pittsburgh was a big decision. I remember I cried and cried when he left. But New York City, wow.
First met Keith in 1978. It was probably my first week at school, at School of Visual Arts. I heard this Devo music, and there was Keith in this room, and he was painting to the beat of these black lines, and he was kind of like painting himself into the corner.
Some of the other countries that you have done some work in?
All over the world, really. Germany, France, London, South America, Japan, Holland, Spain, and around the United States.
Yeah.
I mean, I make lots of things that are on permanent or semi-permanent materials, usually paper and or metal and plastic, wood, vinyl. But I like the idea of things lasting longer than you last and being somewhere where lots of people can see them for a long time.
Yeah, so he came up with the solution of painting on tarps. And he purposely chose tarps which were industrial things which are used in the back of trucks with the holes in the grommets so that they hold down so that all the goods that you're carrying across borders and traveling, again, very much to do with travel.
By a man from a museum in Berlin at the museum called the House at Checkpoint Charlie, which is a museum that's dedicated to sort of human rights issues, and he has asked me if I'm interested in painting the Berlin Wall, which of course I am interested in painting. I'm painting this continuous interlocking chain of human figures which are connected at the hands and the feet, and they're alternating between red and black on a yellow ground, so it's the German colors, and really about this sort of obviously somehow about this unity of people and against the idea of the wall, which is separating the people.
Haring opened the pop shop in 1985 on Lafayette Street. It signaled a significant shift in the way that youth culture was going to express itself.
Keith really advanced what an artist could do, taking Andy Warhol's factory one step further into an actual factory store. When you look at what's come since then, particularly Takashi Murakami taking Keith's approach perhaps even further, maybe not so much conceptually further, but pushing it more with a connection with major merchandising companies.
They misunderstood a lot of things that Keith did. I mean, the pop shop they thought was a commercial endeavor. He wasn't going to get rich off of selling t-shirts and blow up pillows and buttons. This wasn't about money. It was about accessibility, and it was about him reaching people, and it was about spreading the creative energy that he had.
Partly at the prodding of Tony, I've become interested in to try to do some, to translate some of my things into large outdoor sculptures and into public kind of sculptures. And Tony has arranged through to do an exhibition at Castelli Gallery.
just insisted. You know, okay, now this year I have a show in Paris, and I have a show in Milano, and I have a show in wherever, and that's great, and I've got to produce all this work, but I insist that when I go to be present at my exhibition in whatever country or city, I also want to do something lasting and meaningful that will remain, something that will help people, and, you know, something that brings joy. And so that is why, even today, in any number of cities around the world, there remain Keith Haring murals, because fortunately people value them not for their art market value, but for their spirit.
I mean, I do all kinds of things. Sometimes they're temporary and sometimes they last forever.
There's a new museum that's just been built in Antwerp, and they asked me to do a permanent mural inside the museum in the cafeteria, which I do. Beautiful thing in Belgium, where I spend 3 weeks in Knokke painting, and I'm living while I'm there inside of this house that has been made by Nicky de St. Valentin's and Lee, on the property of the Nellens, and in this enchanted house. I'm living with his family and having an incredible time.